Hi there, Omar is here with a not about Windows 7 video. I was planning to, but there is a demand for Windows 6, famously known as Windows Vista.
My new computer came with Windows 7. Windows 7 is much more user-friendly than Windows Vista. I don't like that.
So, let's install Windows Vista on modern hardware, like an Intel Raptor Lake CPU launched this year. What can go wrong? We boot from the optical drive, the setup will start, and because Windows Vista knows how to deal with a HCI interface, our SATA SSD or hard drive will be promptly detected. The optical drive operates under the same protocol. There is no need to install any extra drivers, and most likely the installation will run with no surprises. Unless maybe there is something wrong with our installation disk. So far, this was an easy job because no USB port was asked to join the party. The setup started from a SATA DVD drive, and since the motherboard has PS2 ports, I use them for the best compatibility. If we have to use USB during the installation, then we might be in trouble. Out of the box, Vista supports up to USB 2, but newer motherboards are using USB 3.1 or newer chipsets. Without drivers, Vista simply can't deal with USB 3. And this ends with a catastrophic failure to recognize mouse and keyboard. As you may know, USB mouse and keyboard can operate in legacy mode, being emulated by the BIOS as PS2 devices. This way, we can use an USB keyboard in DOS or in Windows 98. But this emulation won't help either, because as soon as Vista tries to initialize the USB bus, the emulation is lost, so still no mouse and keyboard. So, what can we do? First, we can try to solve the USB issue. You can use VLite to integrate USB 3 drivers into a custom-made Vista ISO. There are many USB 3 chips that are compatible with Vista, but now the USB 3 is a part of the chipset, so we need a driver either from AMD or Intel. But Intel decided to not support Vista when it comes to USB 3, so there are no official drivers. Technically, if we enable XHCI handoff option in BIOS, the USB 3 should reconfigure itself as being a USB 2, and this way the operating system could use a standard USB 2 driver to deal with it. But in real life, doesn't work. Vista still can't do anything about USB 3. As you would expect, Vista fans managed to find a way and backported some Intel USB 3 drivers made for Windows 8 into Vista. These drivers will do the job if we already have a working Vista setup. Unfortunately, it looks like they can't be used during the installation. I did try to integrate these drivers, but it didn't work, most likely because a later update is required for this backported drivers to work, so no luck. So far I had a perfect USB support using a classic VIA6212 chip packed in a PCI Express solution with the help of a PCI Express to PCI bridge chip. Such an PCI Express adapter would solve the USB issues not only in Vista, but in every other Windows released before Vista, including Windows XP and Windows 98. So I strongly recommend to get one. Also, just in case, make sure that you pick a motherboard with at least one PS2 port. While some new motherboards are starting to skip the PS2 port, there are still many options with at least one PS2 port, not to mention some top-of-the-line motherboards like this Asus Apex 790, which still offers two classic PS2 ports. Now, let's assume that we do have a dusty PS2 keyboard and we can resume Windows Vista installation. What if we don't have any optical drive? It's a fact, optical drives are not so common nowadays. Can we install it using a bootable USB stick? Well, this is a very hot Windows Vista topic with over 14 million Google search results on how to install Vista from USB. I think we may already know how to install Vista from USB. We use a program like Rufus and we end with a bootable USB stick, but the USB 3 problem is still there. Even if the hard drive is properly detected, Vista won't install if our bootable stick is connected to some unsupported USB 3 interface. If you wonder why the keyboard and mouse are not detected at all, but we can start the installation from a USB 3 port, the answer is emulation. Usually the USB stick is emulated as a hard drive, so the installation can start normally, but this won't help us. Vista still asks for drivers. The good news is that we can perform a fresh install of Vista directly from hard drive. Every Windows before Vista can be installed this way, and things didn't change when Vista was launched. Except DOS is not used anymore. The procedure is basically the same. First, we need a bootable partition. We copy the installation files on it. We boot from that partition and we start installation, usually by typing setup. If you watch my videos before, you may already know that I advocate for this method in every Windows setup video. So let's get started. First, let's prepare our installation drive. Obviously, we need a partition where Vista can be installed. This operation can be done using this part, or we can open Disk Management tool and we can achieve the very same results with a few mouse clicks. Here I'm deleting a former Windows XP partition and I'm making a new one for Vista. Let's say 100 gigabytes. Why not? We press next, we get a drive letter. Let's type a volume label, and the most important step is to make this partition active. For this, we right-click and select Mark Partition as Active, and that's it. Now it's time to make the partition bootable by using the bootsect tool from the Vista installation disk. The boot sector is a serious business, of course, and we have to start the command prompt with admin rights. On my configuration, Vista installation disk is the drive K, so that's why I type K colon. Now I have to navigate inside the boot folder using the cd command. Now a bootsect needs to know two things: which is the target drive and what type of master boot record to write on it. So we have to type bootsect slash NT60. This is the master boot record type, which works for Vista and later, and the target drive. On my configuration is drive E. We add a slash force switch to secure the deal. Now let's copy the contents of the Vista installation disk directly to the installation drive. We can skip a few files, but to not create any confusion, let's select all and copy the whole disk directly to the fresh made bootable partition. At this point, we are ready to restart and we can boot directly from the hard drive we prepared for Vista installation. And here's the magic happening. Since we have the contents of the installation disk on the hard drive, the setup will start automatically. Inside the boot folder, there is a BCD file. BCD stands for boot configuration data. And this file is configured to look for a setup exe and start the installation process. But because of this exact BCD file, we have to interrupt the setup process and delete the file. We need it only once, or else at the next reboot, we are going to start all over again. To interrupt the initial setup process, we hold the control key when we see Windows is loading files and a command prompt window will pop up. To delete the BCD file, we type delete C colon slash boot slash BCD. Then we type bcd edit forward slash create store. After completing these two last steps, now we are qualified to resume the setup. So we are going to navigate to the C drive. And here we have the sources folder. And we navigate inside this folder and we type setup. Well, the setup will start once again, but this time there is no missing CD DVD device driver, and we finally can install Vista. Obviously, we are not going to format the C drive since our installation files are there. We just let the setup do its thing, and on a fast computer like this, it's a matter of minutes to see the desktop. Now let's do some updates. The service packs and every single update for Vista are still downloadable from the Microsoft website. Installing service packs will take some time, so we better start with an updated installation ISO in the first place. Anyway, if we download the platform update and a later Windows Server 2008 update, we are qualified to install the extended kernel, which is obviously the most unofficial update possible. With an extended kernel, we can run apps that require Windows 7 or newer, like a more recent version of Firefox or Chrome. Usually, we need a newer browser to get along with YouTube. There are quite a few browsers that are YouTube compatible and will work with the original Vista kernel, so it's not absolutely necessary to use the extended kernel if you don't want to. I picked Maxton for a test run. I have used this browser in the past. It's based on Chromium. It claims that it has over 600 million user base. I don't know. Here is it in action in YouTube.
Nice.
Now it's time for some final thoughts. Well, on a modern system, Vista is snappy and the interface has a certain atmosphere, can't deny it. But back in January 2007, when it was launched, maybe it wasn't the best option for a Pentium 4 single core CPU. Using the extended kernel, we can install some GeForce 10 series GPUs. And we might go for something like the Ultimate build using Vista Ultimate Edition. By the way, Windows Vista 64-bit Ultimate can use up to 128 gigabytes of RAM. What about the 32-bit edition? Well, the 32-bit edition is still limited to 4 gigabytes of RAM, but after installing the service packs, it will report the whole memory available in the same fashion as the 64-bit edition. I guess this was a request from the industry in the days when people were buying 4 gigabytes of RAM, but Windows reported only 2 or 3 gigabytes, most of the time because of some BIOS or motherboard limitations. Speaking of RAM, let's end the video with a Rage, a game which is perfectly happy with 4 gigs of RAM, and it was launched when Vista was still fully supported.
Got a plan that might get us both out of this mess. Ah, here we are, home sweet home.
Now let's really end the video with some 3D Mark action. Thanks for watching. What Windows edition would you like to see in the next video? Please leave a comment.